For those who have seen the first video, welcome back. Newcomers are advised to watch the previous video first, but essentially we'll be crafting a party-based game with active combat based on the Dungeon Siege franchise. So, Dungeon Siege 4, just take Dungeon Siege 1's core gameplay loop and add Dungeon Siege 2's combat and add an involved story that ties every companion, NPC, and location together. Yep, that's all we need. Thanks for coming and drive safely. We'll need much more than that, of course. I'm including timestamps in case you want to revisit the section again. I'll be tossing ideas around like nobody's business. Some topics will inevitably include others as well. I apologize in advance if I sound incoherent at times. I just wanted to make sure I included as many ideas and mechanics as I could in order to approach this from all angles. I really hope to see a Dungeon Siege 4 one day, either under the same title or under a different one, acting as a spiritual successor. Let's run the 1 minute nostalgia ride again and start the video. Dungeon Siege 1 and 2 are similar in many ways, but fundamentally different in other. Both games are about forging a party that has the means to advance in four skill lines in a world full of monsters and loot. I think most of you will agree that the greatest difference is that of teleporter-based gameplay. While Dungeon Siege 1 has no teleporters, no respawning enemies, and manual save slots that you should use as your own checkpoints, Dungeon Siege 2 has teleporters, respawning enemies that degrade loot, and one save slot per campaign. Each time you load a save, your party spawns at one of the three towns, whichever area you were in last. If a Dungeon Siege 4 is to be made, then the wisest option for me, in my opinion, would be to opt for no teleporters, as opposed to almost all other titles out there that have some sort of teleportation mechanic, such as fast travels or hubs, where you return after each mission. That's not to say teleporters don't have benefits. Because of teleporters, the player can freely travel between explored areas, do side quests, or pockets of areas they've missed. But revisiting areas to complete side quests is just one way of handling quests. While it is convenient, if it hinders the rest of the game as a whole, if it fails to keep the action going by constant back and forth traveling, then maybe it is not worth it in a franchise where your only mission is to kill enemies and to kill enemies, not to hunt for side quests. My other reason to opt for no teleporters is very simple. It is unique. Teleporters have become the norm, and we seem to have forgotten the simpler times where we had one single story comprised of a sequence of well-thought-out areas. Dungeon Siege 2 is more than fine with teleporters, because the game even wants you to play it at least three times to reach level 100 on Elite difficulty playthrough. You could fix difficulty and story and still could have teleporters, but it would be a step away from what the game's strong points are. Urgency throughout the wilderness, party and gold management are all strong points of the franchise, at least in my opinion, and teleporters undermine all these. This would be the skeleton to the gameplay loop of Dungeon Siege 4. Kill enemies from one town to the next as you progress through an unforgiving wilderness. Things that players point out as flaws in Dungeon Siege, to my experience, are related to class balance and a lack of proper skill system. None of it has anything to do with this unforgiving, no-teleporter journey approach. With a well-crafted world, with well-crafted fighting styles, such a linear construction pulls players in more than an aimless open-world game. While this implicitly means seamless world and no loading screens, only the budget of the developers for Dungeons Age 4 will determine whether no loading screens is feasible. Otherwise, I don't believe players will have a problem with loading screens. This is a model, of course, and does not take into account some cases which we will mention in due course. Towns won't be old towns. They will be outposts, camps, hamlets, a lonesome caravan, maybe even a safe group with a genie in the middle that acts as a trader. Dungeons are not just dungeons. They are a variety of hostile environments filled with enemies and bosses, by the end of which progress has been made on the main quest. The difficulty levels must be varied. The game will become harder and harder to balance as we go on in this video, especially considering a large party with a variety of combinations, so a sound idea is to add customization options for difficulty. It should be alterable during the game in order not to scare too many players in getting stuck in an area and attracting more experienced players on harder difficulty settings. Perhaps even including a hardcore mode that removes the resurrection scrolls or severely limits them to one or two purchases per town. There are many ways to make your game more accessible, but normalizing the difficulty to one option is not one of them. The game's autosave function should be customizable, for example autosaving every 15 minutes, and maybe even take a hard save whenever a player enters a dungeon. One great advantage we have, thanks to our times, will be patches and mods. Dungeon Siege has had a fantastic modding scene since its release, and it is a tradition we must hold up to. Patches after the game's release can balance the game further, and I can already imagine countless mods released for a fourth game, from new spells and companions to complete overhauls. Perhaps a new game plus mode could well be considered, allowing players to retain their original hero or up to several characters to start the game anew, like Dungeon Siege 2's veteran and elite modes. Again, it should not detract any attention from the main experience. The party size will be 8 members again, although one might concede to 6 as well for better balance depending on how combat looks like, provided that you don't need to wait to unlock the additional slots like in Dungeon Siege 2. I've discussed in the second game how a smaller party meant more interesting boss fights, since the game can now force you to maneuver your party. Having 8 members would force the player to pause the game a lot, so maybe even with 6 players, additional formation mechanics where you can group people up could be interesting. With such an inclusion, you could even have 10 party members. Easy selection of groups customized by the player, such as front guys or rangers, allowing players to navigate party members with less pause time. In all fairness, however, nothing beats the fun I had from 8 party members literally committing genocide in the forests of Ebb. Pack mules are something to consider because you don't have any teleporters now. They could consist of different kinds of pack animals in general, and perhaps even encountered in the wilderness that can be recruited, for example next to an abandoned, looted caravan. Number of potential companions should be ample and varied. The player shouldn't wait 3 dungeons long until they encounter another nature mage. Developers by now should know that the players will want to try full archer or full nature mage parties, and the game should plan for that. I see great potential in the party members themselves. The game could consider their backgrounds such as culture and religion, or examine past grievances between acquaintances. Solid banter and fleshed out personalities already go a long way, and by now we have already seen how many quests we like from other games just involve menial gameplay tasks, while having amazing dialogue or artistic setting. I can't even imagine how much increase the game's replayability would get with such additions. This requires great commitment on the developer's end to the story and narrative, something that can potentially hinder the mantra "keep the action going." If the player constantly enters dialogue to do quests, or spends too much time in towns where there are NPCs, then they won't spend as much time doing hacking and slashing. There are many ways to circumvent this, meaning there are ways to have a game rich in story while not being an impediment to the gameplay. And I will give some examples that we can use in Dungeon Siege 4 before moving on to combat in detail. Once the player enters a town, and by town I mean any safe area with a trader that is between two dungeons, they can quickly identify where the main quest updater is, if there is even one. Merchant NPCs should also be nearby to conserve time, or at least on the path leading to the town's exit. The player can then quickly update their main quest, if it needs any updating at all, go to the traders, sell loot and buy gear, and move on. No further dialogue or search is necessary unless you are specifically looking for town exploration, companions, or side quests. Potential lore and side quests can be spread around the town. Maybe you want to spend some time in the tavern before moving out. You hear an interesting story about a mythical cave. You are being rewarded for exploring the areas and talking to people. The man gives you a map that you figure out along the way. Find the cavern and get the loot. Maybe it is about delivering something to the next town, an item that takes up large inventory space. Maybe it's worth to accept the quest and put it in your inventory if you have a pack mule. The land, as we call it, might not be a united country. This not only enhances the story, but also the enemies and areas that emerge from that story. Different cultures could be friendly or aggressive towards you. Maybe clearing an area would help out, and this companion will like you more, so he joins your party. Party banter, as we have seen from games such as Dragon Age, is perfect for the Dungeon Siege franchise. Dungeon Siege 2 often included such banters, but they could appear in mid-combat and the banter would cancel. Today, we have the means to reflect this banter with the hovering dialogue or subtitles. If enemies attacked mid-banter, the interlocutors could say something like, "Hold that thought," and then kill enemies and continue talking. The first game had few books the player could read, and the second game included detailed quest entries, bestiary, and the map of the land. These are beneficial elements that only need further expanding, providing the player with means to access the game's deeper lore without obstructing the gameplay. The journal could include codex entries, similar to the bestiary of the second game. So far, we have assumed a symmetrical premise and a limited ending. You are a good person who kills evil creatures until the game is done, but it doesn't have to be this way. Multiple endings and branching paths are always a problem not just for story writers, but also for level designers themselves. XP earned from all branches should be around equal, or players will lose out on gameplay material. If the land is somewhat disunited or is partially invaded, the player could be presented with different factions to side with on their way. This is a cliché example, but imagine you have to confront Baron Bolingar IV because he's been abusive to the villagers. You'll travel to his keep, which is a dungeon area on its own, and its exit loops back to the town you've been in. Only this time, you'll continue to another location once you resupply. If you side with the villagers after encountering Bolingar, he'll escape to the denizens of his keep. If not, then you'll return to the village to slaughter the garrison and the citizens, or something along those lines. In both branches, XP earned between the decision made and the beginning of the next dungeon should be around equal. Though in this case, if the developers cannot account for a case where the player gets away with slaughtering an entire town, either by having a storyline that makes sense within this framework or by moving the player to a geography where that choice doesn't matter as much, then maybe they shouldn't involve killing innocent villagers. If the game can explain it, then maybe some NPCs you have met earlier are encountered in later towns. Looking at this map, it doesn't seem feasible because there's only one way forward. But this map also has only two towns in an entire kingdom, so it isn't the most realistic. Naturally, your path wouldn't be the shortest to the end game because you have taken some urgent story detours here and there. Companions could comment on choices and maybe even leave the party or force an ultimatum. Zed is a pompous sorcerer who carries a bottle of perfume. Maybe that's why he doesn't like being in Seacrest's party, the Lascansi origins of which Zed detests. The game could offer temporary companions that could help players out in tougher areas. They would independently follow your party for the duration of a certain area, deal a moderate amount of damage, and maybe guide you through an area with a secret. Or we could scratch this health companion method completely and introduce them as full party members until they prompt a dialogue that informs the player that they wish to leave the party. Some of these temporary companions could turn into permanent ones if you satisfy certain conditions, such as the death of a certain enemy, or completion of a side quest, or having someone else in your party. With temporary companions amidst permanent ones that split into several categories, sometimes depending on choices, the game could be filled with companions and encourage you to often make adjustments to your party. You find Andaimus in the swamps. He got lost when chasing the goblins who stole Phaedriel's prize. Since he was trying to do good for Phaedriel, maybe he doesn't charge you as much if you have her in your party. Or maybe having her in the party installs some trust in Andiamus, and he suggests you look for his baggage around the swamps, which he lost. Maybe he wants to leave the party after the goblins have been dealt with and return to the traveler's camp. Maybe he can go on, but in order to convert him from temporary to permanent, you need to pay. This doesn't mean the player has wasted their time with them, as he would drop all his items on the ground before abandoning party, and ample amount of companions would always assure the player of alternatives. In short, the game can contain amazing lore and storytelling without being an impediment to gameplay. The problems existing within this scheme would not be fundamental, they would be temporal, awaiting testing, balancing, and fine-tuning. Side note to companions, the game could include pets, mystical creatures that have been tamed by beastmasters located in towns, or adopted beast puppies of hermits living in isolated locations. The biggest problem with pets in Dungeon Siege 2 was that you had no idea what pets could do aside their skill type. If the players could have some insight on what they would evolve to prior to recruiting them, then by all means we could accommodate pets in a party of 6 or 8. Now, combat is much more complicated, and we have to start with items. The connection between items, attributes, and skills is different in both games. In Dungeon Siege 1, attributes determine the items you are wearing, so any person with 15 strength can wear 15 strength armor, regardless of their fighting style. In Dungeon Siege 2, everyone will wear their own class armor. The same applies for weapons, and while in the first game you could expect fighters to use decent bows as the game progresses, it is not possible in the second game. If you wish to level your range skill as a fighter to invest into skill points, you have to accept the fact that he won't be dealing any damage at all while he tries leveling up. Attributes advanced slowly in the first game, so it took more time for players to switch to better items once they leveled up. Since the item requirement duty is transferred from attributes to skills in Dungeon Siege 2, you reach level requirements for items much faster. Coincidentally, attributes also level up much faster in Dungeon Siege 2. As you can see, my character is close to the endgame, and his intelligence already exceeds the max level for Dungeon Siege 1. I think the best idea here is to keep player freedom open and opt for attributes as item requirements whilst accelerating attribute leveling. The skills could then provide additional bonuses in respective weapon types. A fighter gains about 2.5 points of strength by the time they reach Stonebridge. If he had gained 10 points in strength in that amount of time and distance, then it means he could have gained maybe 5 strength and 3 intelligence instead, making him more suitable for a battle mage role. The leveling curve must become somewhat flatter to broaden the possibilities, both in terms of party composition and item variety. Suddenly, it doesn't take 3 quarters of a dungeon to level dexterity to the next level, so you can equip that nice bow. This means acquired loot and equipped items will get older at a faster rate. Chances are the item drops will be more hectic than Diablo or Grimdawn. Your armor might be outdated for your character by the time you finish the dungeon. But items are not merely levels and armor value. They give armor on top of combinations of buffs on items, in addition to their sell value. Both games have suffered from many buffs that were not thought through. Many buffs on items and item sets themselves fail to consistently scale at later levels. I don't think I need to emphasize the importance of loot. A proper algorithm that calculates the attribute requirement based on the combination of stats, in addition to developer interventions, that's necessary. I think this is something that could go either way. Both options have the potential to include mixed requirement gear, although it sounds more intuitive for attributes than it is for skills. Each item the player wears needs to be utilized to the fullest extent. Each spellbook can have an orientation to start with, for example, providing bonus damage or bonus healing, or bonus summons or bonus buff durations. On top of a singular orientation, players could enchant their spellbooks with certain runes to invest more in them if they are fond of the buff combinations. Dungeon Siege 2 had an enchantment system, and the fourth installment could well accommodate such item customization. Unique regions could be found in the wilds or by completing side quests. The player wears 4 rings and an amulet. The game could have different jewelry styles, for example Glitter Delve style or Grail in Pearl style, you get the idea. You could wear jewelry from different styles, but they could have additional magical synergy that connects jewelry magic to the lore if you wear same style jewelry. essentially item sets in themselves. This isn't just a tip for Dungeon Siege 4, it could be included in every RPG that puts emphasis on item management. It is just yet another step in character customization. Another example would be to put trinkets or artifacts in the game, whatever you call them. Each companion could equip only one of them, and would help fortify their playstyle or help compensate for the weaknesses in defense. In my own attempt at making a game design document for Dungeon Siege 4, I've named them prayer beads, each dedicated to a god. Some companions would refuse to abandon their beads, while others were light believers anyway and happily traded one bead with the next. Here are a few examples. A prayer bead to some god would cause 10% of incoming damage to friendlies that are in a meter radius to be absorbed, a good choice for tanks. Another one would cap 15% of health in return for 8% increased damage output. The numbers could vary. For the godless heathens, no prayer beads equipped could mean your spirit wanders around for a few seconds before you die, terrifying enemies around you before fleeting away, providing your party the window of opportunity to resurrect them or finish up the fight. Many side quests or secret areas could yield unique trinkets. The regular or common trinkets, however, should be available at every town, so that the players can adapt their companions to different playstyles and compositions. Dungeon Siege 1's equipment tab allowed for quick switching between melee and ranged, since all players had a dedicated range slot. There is no reason not to have this mechanic. As we have discussed, parties often feel the need to resort to ranged weapons, because they are running out of health or mana potions. Now, this goes against the smaller, dedicated party gameplay of Dungeon Siege 2, but allow me to entertain the idea. If party management were far smoother, then you'd prefer your warriors to shoot two arrows or throw a javelin before charging in. Switching between fighting styles should be as intuitive as possible for both one character and the entire party. You should be able to save presets for your party and name them at your own leisure. In addition to presets, the addition of tactics could also benefit, although I am skeptical about this. Essentially, a tactic would be a character automatically drinking a health potion when his health drops, or switching to healing wind when two or more members have lower than 50% health, or prioritize healing for your squishy DPS character instead of tank. If the player has plenty of things to think of during combat, then they would appreciate the addition of such tactics and not consider them to be autopilot. One thing we haven't yet mentioned amongst all this is whether to include skill points and skill trees. The next question would be then about powers. Although I really enjoy a system where I don't spend any artificial points, it may be a necessary concession to make.
Players of Dungeon Siege 2 enjoyed how they could specialize their companions in certain categories, such as better health or better curses or better ice damage. Suddenly, nature mages weren't just healing wind plus one viable damage spell, like in Dungeon Siege 1. They enjoyed many passives that benefited their buffs or summons.
In addition to this, the fact that hired companions came with unspent skill points meant that the player had more agency in new coming party members. I am personally undecided on this, but I don't see a major reason why we shouldn't include them. My own twist would be to make skill trees for attributes and not skills. What I am more interested in is powers and how overpowered they would be in a party of 8 members. There is no need to just discard them outright, so we have a few options. The most obvious one is to scale off powers based on party size. A party of 3 members will have better powers individually than a party of 8. The latter's powers will be weaker, but since 8 different people can cast them, they have better variety and combinations. There is already some bias towards this, since a smaller party will receive more XP, presumably making powers stronger by nature. That way, you can still have powers, though they won't be overpowered in large parties and underpowered in smaller parties. A problem that emerges here are the hotkeys. If the numbers switch weapon types, how to quickly activate powers? Tactics mechanic can play a role here. Just set it so that if there are more than 4 enemies in the vicinity, use taunt or provoke as we know from Dungeon Siege 2. Target miniboss and boss type enemies once take aim is charged. In addition to hypothetical tactics, I'm imagining the user interface will mostly resemble Dungeon Siege 1 in terms of style. Controlling and ordering individual party members was hard in the second game, but the first one allowed for a variety of ways to micromanage. None of the elements in this box here are presented in Dungeon Siege 2. Nor are they required, actually, because you have a small party, and as we have established, the game wants your party to be a wrecking ball. Allow me to get more creative. My idea seriously undermines the potency of powers, but I think it complements what we have said about Dungeon Siege 4 so far. Powers should still reflect their classes. A shield person should taunt. Two-handed guys can stun enemies. Dual-wield deals faster attacks. Crossbow bolts can penetrate. Thrown weapons can ricochet. Bows are fast and accurate. These traits are the principal examples, but there can be additions, surely. Maybe you want to have a shield guy, but you don't need him to taunt. So he uses shield bash to stun enemies occasionally in a 45-degree frontal cone. Two-handed could have a swing attack, you get the idea. Unlike Dungeon Siege 2, they will be far more modest in depiction. They won't be reflected as artificial powers that you acquire with skill tree unlocks, but intuitive extensions of the weapons themselves. It's hard to describe what even I cannot see, but bear with me here. You have a person who uses a two-handed weapon. You can either set a tactic so that he uses the stun power whenever it is charged, or use it manually. When he does stun, he strikes with the pommel end of his sword and knocks the enemy down. Except, you don't see flames ablaze or purple auras emerging out of you. When you use taunt and your guy bashes his shield, maybe a very, very modest air wave could emerge, but that should be it. The rest should be left to the sound of the shield bash and the warrior's cry. They should be reflecting what these brute companions are doing with a brute reality. The thunderous shot ability should shoot a high power arrow or bolt that pierces its target and carries on and stuns the enemy. But the enemies don't explode into pieces because all you do is shoot a powerful bolt that pierces its target. The twist here is that the powers wouldn't be powers. They wouldn't be abilities that deal 5000% weapon damage. They would act as the side effects of the weapon you are using, much like the passives at the end of the skill trees in Dungeon Siege 2. Only this time, you don't have to play the game again on Veteran and Elite difficulty to see such effects take place frequently. These subclasses and their principal effects become part of the composition at the first minute of the game. Completion of item sets or possession of trinkets could unlock better powers, namely those that look unworldly. The bottom line is that each power the player can use should come from their weapon style and reduce to an exaggerated but organic expression. The emphasis is not on individual companions doing amazing feats, but your party working together, each part of an important machine. Item selection and party composition all feeds into this. I know a lot of it sounds vague so far because it depends so much on other things, such as the skill tree, items, and weapon balance. Here's another idea. Here we have strength, dexterity, and intelligence. We haven't talked about what increased levels in melee, ranged, nature, and combat magic do, but for now let's just say that they give increased damage in respective skill types. Strength increases melee damage, health, and health regeneration. Intelligence increases magic damage, mana, and mana regeneration. Dexterity increases things like dodge and range damage, and recovery. It is something I've made up. In Dungeon Siege 2, powers had base recharge rates and a few items boosted this, but that was it. Recovery could serve as an additional value that dexterity increases. Over the course of the game, ranged weapon users have faster charging powers, and these organic powers become part of their regular damage output. This would be part of a larger attempt at making ranged more viable. They should be powerful at range, but only at range. The player must actively look out for their archers and make sure only a handful of enemies get through. While interruption is annoying, I think archers should get interrupted. At least 20% of the time an enemy is at their face. I think in both games, melee was far more viable than ranged. While the second game addressed some of its issues, it is always struck midway between dealing damage and surviving. The effect of a man who shoots a longbow at short distance is devastating, and the game must reflect this, while also reflecting the protection they need. While melee players will be dealing great melee weapon damage and soak up good amount of incoming damage with armor and health, they won't be using their powers as much. You could imagine a two-handed swordsman stunning an enemy or two, but I imagine every 5 or 6 shots of the archer would be something similar to take aim, dealing great damage with the bow. Or maybe you want the archer to use rapid shot, meaning for example they actually draw 3 arrows from their quivers and fire 3 shots very rapidly. You could even have spraying arrows like this, although I imagine its base recharge rate would be higher compared to others. The depiction of spraying arrow would be again organic. The archer drawing several arrows and shooting enemies in a 45-degree frontal angle, from left to right. The shots should land in a very quick succession, but not instantly. Keep in mind that any fighter can use any melee weapon if he has enough strength, or melee skill if you decide on skills, not attributes determine items. What this means is that if you want your shield guy to switch to two-handed after some portion of the game, you can, it's simple. Another proposal of mine is to split dual wield into strength and dexterity. Thanks to recovery, they will use their powers far more often. The downside is that their strength will be lower, so they will wear weaker armor in comparison to other melee users, as well as lower HP. Thanks to their better dexterity, they can use better bows when needed as well. If you have good supporting mages, maybe you want to double down on that dual-wielding barbarian by using a trinket that reduces his HP but increases his damage output. We haven't talked about mages yet, and we'll come to them in a bit. So far, it looks like mages won't have anything to do with powers. It might be the case, as mages will use a variety, a true variety of spells, and don't need powers to be cool. Also, you could ask the following question. If dual wield is a hybrid between strength and dexterity, why not have one with dexterity and intelligence, or strength and intelligence? I've thought on it, I still do. Special mage staffs could be a hybrid of melee and intelligence that have their own powers, or special mage darts that split between dexterity and intelligence. It is good to know we can accommodate their possibility, thanks to a larger party and a more forgiving leveling system, but I can't think it through without exploding my brain. I wanted to spice up the gameplay a bit by adding recovery and making dual wield split between strength and dexterity. My initial plan was to apply the strength requirement for stronger bows, like in Dungeon Siege 1. But as I go down that route, I've realized it gets messier and messier. This was the final point I had ended up on, what I call the physical damage scale. As you can see, it is quite complicated. It doesn't even account for the possibility of special mage staffs or darts like we have mentioned before. I'm leaving it here in case we need a much more complex alternative to our current mechanics. A few words on magic in the first and second game. Nature magic has always had this tendency to lag behind combat magic. The reason isn't that it's bad. I cannot imagine doing Dungeon Siege 1 on hard mode without healing wind. Dungeon Siege 2 manual advises you to at least pick one nature mage so you have healing, buffs, and immunity to curses. And all of it is true. The problem is that you never have the reason, the urgency, to pick a second, third, or fourth nature mage, unlike combat magic where they hit harder than anyone else. One nature mage can heal during combat and cast summons and buffs outside it. You only need so much healing power before you replace that second nature mage with someone who dishes out real damage. If nature magic had more damage options, then it would be OP. If combat magic had proper healing, nature magic would be useless. Summons and buffs are great, but again, only one nature mage is required for them. I'd like you to keep these points in mind before we start how magic should look like in the fourth game. The magic system of Dungeon Siege 2 was a significant step from the previous game, from being objectively least fun playstyle to objectively most fun. Four active spells instead of two, and four autocast spells were a blessing. I think the autocasts can be easily integrated with the aforementioned tactics system. Instead of just putting a healing spell on autocast, you can also modify when this healing spell will be autocast. It is useful if you don't want your party member to stop everything and heal someone when they drop to 90% health. In both games, magic splits into two classes, nature and combat magic. Again, there are a few options here. One is to obviously keep the separation and just spice things up with better spells. Other is to merge them all under the skill magic, then work magic subclasses into skill trees and spell types, just like with melee and ranged. An item wouldn't require 10 levels in either nature or combat magic, it would only require magic. This makes magic more similar to other skills with regards to leveling, but removes any distinction between mages. Now I have an idea to reintroduce a distinction. It is totally new to the franchise, but I think it complements the gameplay much more than what we had in the first two games. Assuming magic is one skill, let's have the following magic subclasses: Unmaking, Restoration, Invocation, and Spirit as example names. All subclasses have at least one or two damage spells, but the best ones will be at Unmaking. Its repertoire will mostly resemble destructive combat magic spells. Next, we have restoration, which will include healing spells, buffs, and spells that remove friendly debuffs. Invocation includes summoning creatures to help you. In addition to this, they could summon minor totems and the like from the ground that slowly heals allies in a small radius, applies debuffs to nearby enemies, and so on. Finally, spirit spells involve terrifying opponents, applying curses, maybe summoning dead enemies to help you. You get the idea. They don't really look balanced now, but ignore that for a second. Now, any spellcaster will increase his magic skill. However, the game will track how frequently you use each type of magic subclass and will dynamically alter your concentration based on last spells cast. So if you keep casting unmaking spells all the time, your concentration in unmaking will rapidly increase. If you squeeze in invocation spells every so often, for example once or twice during a minute of combat, you will see that unmaking concentration has dropped because invocation concentration has increased a bit. The character's concentration is now split between unmaking and invocation, but they all gain points in magic equally. Hang on. If there's a limit to concentration, then it doesn't matter whether my guy has been an unmaking mage since day one, because he will reach his concentration cap in a bit anyway. That's true. Before I address that problem, consider the early and mid game. You have one or two mages in your party. If everything has gone smooth in development of the game, then you are constantly bombarded with encounters that you need to find a workaround for. Now you realize this isn't just a point and click game. I cannot just spam damage spells. I have to use certain stuff from other schools. You are actively encouraged and urged to try out different spells, because the spells are there for a reason. There will be items and trinkets that alter concentration, acceleration, or the maximum limit. If we are going to include skill points, then maybe X amount of skill points invested in magic tree, or intelligence depending on the system, could increase the base cap of all subclasses by 5%. An additional benefit of this system is that it allows for a fighter or a ranger to use spells more smoothly. Your tank may use self-healing all the time, but his magic skill will increase very slowly. At least by only sticking to restoration spells, he will have some additional healing thanks to his concentration in restoration. Before moving on to my other idea about magic, I just wanted to remind you that you can use this concentration system for melee and ranged as well, if you want. I don't think it would fit as much because how melee and ranged plays out individually and in party composition, but it's quite possible. My other idea involves mana. I never minded this until I saw a comment on the internet one day about another game, saying that mages were being ripped off because they were restricted to their mana pool while fighters could swing swords all day long. Many games have a stamina mechanic that prevents this. In Dungeon Siege, more mages you have, less money you will have at ready because you will constantly buy mana potions. In Dungeon Siege 4, with no teleporters approach, plenty of money will be spent stockpiling up on mana potions. I am not a huge advocate of this idea, but how about normalizing mana to 100? Basic attack spells will have a very small mana cost, while others will have between 40 and 80 or something. Intelligence would then increase mana regeneration only, but at a much, much higher rate. Increase in magic skill would give reduction to spell mana costs as well as increasing damage. For a skilled mage, the Healing Wind spell would cost 12 mana, whereas for a fighter it would be 50. In addition to this, excluding all items and concentration bonuses, the mage will regenerate his mana quickly, while the fighter would need mana potions to keep up that healing. Some item sets, trinkets, or skill points in magic skill could increase that 100 mana cap, but not to 1000 or anything, to perhaps 150. A mage who casts modest spells wouldn't require as much mana unless the fight really prolonged. And if they casted really good spells, such as sending apparitions to terrify the enemy, or casting a buff that increases party-wide dodge rate, they would spend a larger portion of their mana, resorting to mana potions to keep up in combat. As a final suggestion to magic, and maybe the most important one, summons and buffs could really be decisive with the following mechanic, which doesn't require the 100 mana normalization at all, so it can be implemented even with old systems. Some spells could take up mana reserve, then they really have a chance to be part of gameplay. In previous games, you can always cast summons and buffs out of combat that eat up almost all your mana, but then just drink a potion and move on. Reserved mana means your summon and buff choices will be more important. This also allows for multiple summons per party member at the cost of having very little mana left to do anything in combat. For the unexperienced, such as fighters and rangers, this reserve cost would be very high, perhaps even 100, to hinder exploitative gameplay. In both games, the spread of monsters throughout a level are much similar. We can imagine a level that extends from one safe area to the next. At the end of the dungeon, there will be a boss battle. Mini-bosses will be scattered around, some of them in secret areas. The rest of the level will be populated by mobs of different strength and amount. This is nothing new. We know mobs will have resistances or weaknesses, they will attack in a variety of ways. But the game should get more creative with its approaches. You are a party of heroes and you can tackle anything. It should feel like the enemies are throwing everything at you, yet your smart and brave companions endure all challenge. You should encounter small fortifications like outposts that you need to approach in a clever way. Maybe if your party has four fighters with shields, they can run inside and soak up all the damage, while mages blast meteors at enemies. If your party is squishy, maybe you should try a different approach instead. A secret passage? A signal that drives some guards away? Or you just pick them apart one by one? Maybe by flooding an area with poison, you could turn bandits into undead bandits for an extra challenge. The player could be made aware of such difficulty spike options. Just like the triple question mark guy from Dungeon Siege 2, a genie could spawn every so often so you can hit it for loot. Maybe few wise men scattered around the land have some tips on how to deal more damage to him. The dragon fight from Dungeon Siege 2 had you fight against a dragon using a ballista, all the while surviving the mobs thrown at you. The UI should allow you to comfortably select and order party members in smaller squads, making such interactive fights much more interesting and accessible. Mini-bosses in secret areas could involve mini-puzzles that need to be resolved mid-fight. Obviously, there will be a lot of filler areas where the only thing you do is left-click and kill mobs without thinking much, but the player should be given more than kill different-looking enemies in different-looking environments. Speaking of environments, let's talk about the art design. Both games and Dungeon Siege 3 excelled in art design and soundtrack. Both games offered a large variety of locations to visit and fight in. The fourth installment, with a linear, no-teleporter adventure, has the opportunity to make every encounter unique. Dungeon Siege 1 included in-game cutscenes when the player arrived at certain locations. Dungeon Siege 2 had dedicated cinematics and in-game cutscenes for a variety of events. It's time to double down on this concept. What I'm about to explain can also be done with cinematics, surely, but allow me to approach this from an in-game cutscene perspective first. Entering and exiting dungeons should be an event in themselves. The game should let the player observe the outside of the dungeon area as they approach, allowing them to spot locations of interest if possible. Or let the player take a deep breath and enjoy the scenery once the dungeon is over and they are safe for a moment again. If possible, certain vantage points that the player will reach will allow them to look at greater distances, possibly teasing the next towns or dungeons for them. In such instances, there shouldn't be enemies in the immediate vicinity, and the camera should smoothly zoom out twice or triple the distance it normally can, and focus on a certain part of the screen, depending on the occasion. Taking a few steps outside the designated zone, the camera would smoothly zoom in back again to the regular combat camera. Let's give a few examples. Assume the player's objective is to reach a coastal city. They have ascended a mountain, which acted as a dungeon area in itself. Having finished the dungeon, they have arrived at the peak. They expect to encounter some sort of a trader, after which they can descend the mountain to reach the city. Shortly after exiting the dungeon, they arrive at a vantage point. Thanks to the enhanced zoom out and camera focus, they acquire this view. They spot a small town nearby. An ominous monster that watches over the town, sitting on the cliffs. A path leading down the mountain has been blocked by an avalanche. Most importantly, you see the city in the distance. You've fought for an hour and reckon you have another hour of fighting to do before you reach it. You see the sunset, a large fleet approaching in the distance, and so on. All the while, the music played here takes account of this view and plays something accordingly. Party members will comment on the view. Perhaps one of them knows something about that monastery over there. Is it the only way down below, now that the path is blocked with an avalanche? Hours later, you would have navigated through the monastery to reach the other side, and descended the mountain to arrive at lush plains. You spent the entire evening in the monastery, and it is almost pitch dark outside. You arrive at another observation point now that you've exited a dungeon and approaching a town. You suddenly realize what the ships in the distance are. Imagine this happening each time you exit a dungeon and visit a town, and each time you enter a dungeon. Zooming out the camera in a fixed way to introduce the area, its theme, showing few creatures in a distance, maybe a side area that catches your eye. For the towns, it could reveal the overall layout so that the player knows where the entry and exit will be, where the town center or the important building is. The players will enjoy the dedicated view, dedicated soundtrack and level design, and sit back as they relieve their eyes of the monster cries and crashing metal. To drive this point home, let's take a look at Castle Epp from the first game. Imagine the player's end goal has been to reach the King's Castle. You know it's almost overrun, but hurt pockets of resistance are still trying to hold out. They will lower the castle gates for you to come in. This is a cross-section of how the camera will behave when the player approaches the castle. When the party reaches the bridge, the camera will zoom out a bit and lock to a place, informing the player of an event that is important for progression. Then, during the entry stage of the dungeon, camera stays zoomed out and locked in a certain direction. Nearing the actual entrance of the dungeon, the camera will zoom back in. Multiplayer is one crucial element that the first and the second game both nailed, and the trend must go on. A game such as Dungeon Siege is designed with a large party in mind, therefore multiplayer is already served on a silver platter. Customizable difficulty options will enhance the experience for all sorts of players. All players should be able to recruit companions and not just control one character, like in the second game. Perhaps a drop-in feature that allows for quick joining single-player games isn't necessary, provided that importing characters to multiplayer is very easy for two friends who just want to play together. You may see some of my suggestions, such as removal of flashy powers, as a step backwards for the franchise. The vision that I've laid out favors a slower pace. Perhaps for an hour you've been insisting that teleporters are paramount to Dungeon Siege's success. The fourth game should play to the franchise's strength. Dungeon Siege's strengths have always been its main experience on multiplayer. It isn't a game about killing millions of enemies in a few seconds with spamming one skill. It isn't a full-fledged real-time strategy game, nor is it a usual party RPG with very tactical combat. Both games bring unique elements to the table, but I don't think I'm crazy when I say that the first game feels far more unique in comparison to the second. And I base most of this on a lack of teleporters in the first game. A game with teleporters can still work, but again, the chain reaction that sets off once you insert them pulls the second game down to the level of many other action RPGs. Party and inventory management becomes all the more important without teleporters, and the first game really excelled in forcing the player to create an actual budget whenever they reached a trader. It is also for that reason that I've slowed down the pace of combat by introducing things like the organic expression of powers and archers get interrupted. That's not to say I want a slow, bulky combat with frequent pause. The game should just make more use of real-time strategy elements that are etched in its bone. A slower pace is achieved through involved decisions in combat, punishing encounters, and a lack of teleporters that hinder you from returning to towns whenever you want. The difficulty spike that forces you to slow down when killing mobs does not come from inflated boss health from the 15th difficulty level, but it comes from the encounters themselves. There's so much more to talk about, but I think this is a good place to conclude the video. I haven't had the time to mention many ideas, including the most radical one based on Dark Souls-like checkpoint system, but I'm not going to open that can of worms. Some of my points about attributes and skills may have been vague, but the amount of possible combinations prevent me from going deeper in an hour-long video. Chris Taylor has always had ambitious ideas for Dungeon Siege, which explains very well how people are still attached to a 20-year-old franchise, its last proper game released 15 years ago. Part of it is due to nostalgia, of course, but part of it is necessarily due to everything I've just listed about them. I hope I've been correct in my analyses in this and the previous video. If not, then I hope I haven't annoyed you to the point that you wouldn't drop a like or comment below. If not, then I hope I haven't annoyed you to the point that you wouldn't drop a like or comment below the video. As I've said from the start, I hope to create a conversation on how to approach a possible fourth game, and I'm willing to have a chat with everyone who wants to participate. We are all humble dungeoneers of Arana, holding on to the dear relics left by Chris Taylor and Gas Powered Games, awaiting developers or the man himself to create a Dungeon Siege 4 or a spiritual successor. It is my earnest hope that an ancient evil will awaken once again, and we will emerge from our farms to answer the call. Thank you for watching.